Okay, next up is Jay Lazarus. Little bit different change here, design of high-capacity, energy-efficient wells. So we're kind of going from fire and drought and grass management to water.
Good afternoon, everybody. Might be wondering what a groundwater geologist is doing standing up here in front of you folks talking about the design of the high-capacity, energy-efficient wells. Well, without groundwater and without wells, we don't have any CAFOs. So what are we going to do about that? So for efficient water use at dairies, nationwide, agriculture is the largest user of groundwater in the entire country. We use groundwater at dairies for a whole variety of uses, including the cow drinking, milking parlor cleanup, and the irrigation water. And improper well design generally results in increased pumping costs and increases frequency in which your wells or pumps are going to fail and have to be replaced. And inefficient wells will take significantly more energy to pump significantly lesser amounts of water. And this sort of goes back to the questions just a little while ago related to how do we go about making sure that we've got enough water either to have fire suppression, because that's important on our dairies, where lots of times, but unfortunately, we'll have hay fires, okay? And we want to have sufficient water in storage to keep our operations going and to make sure that we've got enough in our tanks in case we have to fight a fire. You know, so as Joe was saying earlier, one of the extension guys was saying earlier about talking to the farmer, well, I really don't know too much about this. Well, and you ask somebody about their wells, that's often the response. And unfortunately, the difference is, in this case, it's very often true. You need water, you hire a driller, he comes in, drills a hole, very often just stuffs pipe. Okay, there's two kinds of drillers in this world. Those that can make a hole and those that can make a well out of it. The ones that just make a hole will get in and out as fast as they can, stuff the pipe in the ground, give you your bill, and they're gone. Whereas a real well driller practices an art and he will make a well out of this hole. This is a municipal well being drilled in northern New Mexico. Originally went to a depth of 900 feet. Because of water quality issues, specifically uranium and fluoride, we ended up completing it back to a depth of about 500 feet. But this is air development while we're developing the well. Okay. So here's three different kinds of wells. In the upper right-hand corner, you see we have an irrigation well. Lower right-hand corner in the middle, we have a domestic well. So one of our field technicians is getting a water level out of that well. And on this lower left-hand corner, this is a municipal well. As you can see, it's inside a well house. It's very freshly painted, well-maintained. And then there's commercial wells, which will be constructed probably a lot more closer to this municipal well. And as you can see, that in the irrigation well in the upper right-hand corner, we've got a line shaft turbine with the motor on top and the pump at the bottom. The pump in this domestic well, the pump and the motor are a submersible pump. And they're set down in the well, and there's a line shaft turbine on this municipal well. Okay. How do we get water into a well? You have to have perforations in your casing, or in the case of these photos, we have manufactured well screen. I would bet right now most of your older irrigation wells and most of the older production wells for the milking parlors and the cows are completed with steel casing and torch cut slots, where you'll have very large torch cuts which will allow a lot of sand in. The most important thing in your screen is the amount of open area that's available for the water to flow into it. In the upper right hand corner, we have louvered screen, and that's constructed at the factory. All casing starts out as a flat sheet and then it's rolled into pipe. Okay? So for the louvered screen, it's rolled into pipe and then it's forced out from the inside out and make the louvers under pressure. Okay? The lower right-hand corner here, that's a wire wrap screen, rod-based screen. It's also referred to as Johnson screen. As you can see, there's a lot more open area in this well screen. You can see the rods that it's wrapped around. These are all stainless steel. These are really expensive well screens because they're stainless steel. These are examples from municipal wells. We would only use a stainless steel screen or a high-strength, low-alloy pipe screen for irrigation or a production well on a farm if we knew there was very funky water quality. And on the lower left side here, we have a mill slot screen. And as you can see, that the slots themselves are wider, and that would allow more sediment or sand to come into the well. Okay. So, you know, why is well efficiency important? Okay. Well, in an efficient well, you know, in an efficient well, we maximize our open area. You know, we want to get the maximum amount of water coming into this well as possible. We have a proper filter pack, or you've heard the terms maybe gravel pack or sand pack in your well. A lot of the irrigation wells have never had one installed. You want to make sure that your screens are not dewatered. Let's take a look at these two wells right here. The one on the left is an inefficient well, where here's your original water level here. Sorry about the pointer, we don't have a laser pointer here. The water level in this inefficient well has drawn down below the screen and down to just above the pump. Whereas the water level in a properly designed efficient well has significantly less drawdown, and it's not drawn down into the screened interval. When you draw your water level down into your screens, you start bringing in sand and sediment and air. If you start bringing in air, you can get cavitation and your casing can actually collapse on you. Okay? So you want in your efficient well, your screens are not dewatered, you're not pumping sand and or air, you've got a properly sized pump and motor, and it minimizes the total dynamic head that you're pumping against. So why is this well efficiency important? Numero uno, you're saving energy, okay? And this is all about, instead of wasting energy, turning this asset into an asset that is functioning efficiently for you and running at maximum efficiency. Your efficient sand-free well is going to save you a whole lot of money on your energy costs to produce the water, and it's going to extend the life of your well and extend the life of your pump, okay? When does a pump fail? And I don't know your last name, Joe, but I know Joe's a farmer. And I know Joe knows all three of these bullets.
No machine ever breaks in the shed.
Yeah, okay. You know, or for your domestic well, when people say, how much storage should I have? Well, your pump's gonna go out at Christmas Eve at 9 o'clock and your in-laws are in town, okay? But no joke, all three of these bullets have happened to clients of ours. And the last one's a real drag because they're going to go to the municipality before they're going to come to the farm. Okay. Well, why does a pump fail? You know, well, they get old. You know, just like any machine, they'll get old and they'll fail. But if you pump too much sand, it'll put wear and tear on your bowls and on your pump and cause the pump to wear out and lose efficiency over its lifetime. Or excessive drawdown, where, especially in a submersible pump, the pumps are cooled by the water circulating through them, okay, versus a line shaft turbine, they've got mineral oil dripping at the surface and that keeps it cool as well as just circulating in the air above it. And you also get air and the well will cavitate on you and, like I said, collapse on the pump. Or what we term other, we normally don't see hay and straw in a pump bowls, but somehow it was able to get into this well. Okay, so what causes the sand production? And, you know, improper screen and filter pack sizing or casing failure, bad wells. I'm gonna show a video here. This well is a well in Utah we did not drill, okay? This is the subject of a lawsuit between the driller and an engineer in Utah. We got hired by the drilling company to evaluate this well video to try and determine the causes of the failure in the well.
would you have? Wire failure?
Well, what it is that the screen and the sand pack, gravel pack, filter pack were not properly sized. You can see the cloudiness in here. And this is a video, the well is pumping, and as we go 360 around, you get little bursts of sand coming into the well. So the way the lawsuit was decided was that it was improperly designed to start with from the engineer. And sorry, there's no video available on this.
So the sand was shooting between the screens?
The sand was shooting in between the wires of the screen, okay? So, you know, where do you want to put your screen in a well? You know, you want to have the best production interval, and you also want to have sufficient water column above that screen to make sure that you're not dewatering. And you also, you know how much, you have an estimate how much your water level is going to drop when you turn your pump on. And if we're going to design these wells for 30 or 40 year life, we also want to have an idea what the average annual drawdown is, because at least in most parts of the western U.S. where we work, you know, we're mining groundwater. So a lot of places we have an annual average water level decline of a foot a year. So over 30 years, we're going to lose 30 feet ahead, and we want to make sure we design that in for the amount of allowable or available drawdown we have above our screens or above our pump. So we talked before a little bit before about the open area on your well screen. So it's your slot size and your slot geometry that dictates or that calculates your total open area. And then your filter pack or gravel pack or sand pack. You know, you see a lot of drillers come in, they'll drill their well, they'll pour in a bunch of pea gravel and tell you that they've got a gravel pack, but all the sand will move right through the pea gravel. The pea gravel's not doing anything for you. So what we do is we'll generally drill a pilot hole, we'll collect formation samples, send them off to the laboratory or the casing or screen manufacturer. They'll run it through a series of sieves, come up with a recommended gravel pack or a filter pack size and a recommended screen size. And we're generally designing to hold back 90% of that formation, bringing about 10% of the fines won't come into any well. So, well development. This becomes one of the most important aspects of designing, drilling, and completing a well. We drill wells, like we'll drill municipal wells 3,500 feet, okay, with 1,500 feet of screen, okay. The most important thing on these wells or a 200-foot irrigation well is the well development. Are you getting the aquifer flowing through your filter pack and into the well? Okay. We'll budget in, like on these very deep wells, we'll budget in an hour of well development for every 5 feet of screen. So we'll have 300 hours of well development in on a 1,500-foot length of screen. And when you're trying to pump, you know, 3,000 or 4,000 gallons a minute for municipality, you know, that money is money well spent. So you can see here in this photo that we've got a well-graded gravel pack here where you've got the coarser materials in closest to your well screen and the finer material of the formation further away. So during the well development, you can well develop either with a baler, you can well develop with air compressors, or you can develop with a pump over time. You don't want to put your pump in until you've used one of the two other methods, because you're not going to pump a bunch of sand through the pump. But you can see the gradation here by the well screen and how the fines are kept further away from it after extended length of period of development. Okay. So how do we design these wells? How do we know where to put the screen? The first thing we do is we try and have either calculated or assume specific capacity. And the specific capacity is how many gallons per minute per foot of drawdown in your well do you have? So if you have a 500 gallon a minute well and you have 50 feet of drawdown, you have a specific capacity of 10, okay? Basically, the bigger, it's this way, okay? The bigger the number for your specific capacity, the better your well is, okay? And so, you know, in the design phase, a lot of times, you know, we're having to estimate the specific capacity rather than calculate it, but you really would like to confirm it with a test pump prior to selecting your permanent pump, and we'll tell you why. Okay. Your specific capacity directly impacts pumping costs. This is real world costs on running a center pivot, on 1,000 acres of land application field in southern Nevada. If you look to the lower right here, okay, here's our specific capacity on the x-axis, the annual energy charge on the y-axis. Right here, the South Gilligan well to pump enough water, probably around 800 gallons a minute out of this well, to irrigate 122-acre center pivot at 9 cents a kilowatt hour with the specific capacity of maybe 18 or close to 20, it's costing us $22,400 a year to run this pivot. If we go over up here to what's called the South Windjammer well, where we have a specific capacity of between 3 and 4, it's costing us $34,000 a year, or more than 50% more than it is to operate the South Gilligan well. Like I say, these are real world costs, and so it's costing us that much more as we're going from the lower right to the upper left on this graph. And all gets back to the well design and completion. Okay. So to maximize the specific capacity, we want to look at the proper screen size and filter pack, where we're going to put the screens across from those high producing areas. We're going to spend a lot of money on well development. You want to make sure you're getting all the mud out of the well and getting all the fines moving through. And whenever we get into heated discussions with our clients about budgeting on these wells, they always want to cut back the well development. That looks simple to them, okay? And this is where your money is most efficiently spent, is developing this well to make sure everything is moved in from the formation. How do you maximize your pump efficiency? You know, once again, this conference is about turning waste into worth. Okay, we don't want to be wasting energy on these wells or producing the water. So we have a good specific capacity. We'll talk about step drawdown test in a second. You select your permanent pump after you've put a test pump in there, because if you oversize your pump, you spent more money on your pump than you need to, and then you're having to choke it back, and you're creating unnecessary artificial head that you're pumping against. Okay, so in our lingo, as groundwater geologists or hydrologists, we have what's called a step drawdown test. You've put your well in, you've developed it, you put in your test pump. Then what we've done here at this well is we have a well that we're able to choke back to lower discharge, and we ran it at three different steps. One step at 440, intermediate step at 870, and the last one at almost 1,300 gallons a minute. So, and this is the graph showing what the drawdown is in each one of these steps. We got 4.5 feet of drawdown in the first step when it pretty much started to stabilize. We kicked the discharge up, started to stabilize a little bit. We kicked the discharge up again, and it kept going down, but it gave us an idea that for a test, we'd be able to run this maybe at close to 1,200 gallons a minute. And this was going to be for a 1 week long pumping test. So using the step test results, you know, what we look at here is that, you know, our predicted, you're able to look at, if we're going to pump at 1,200 gallons a minute, our predicted drawdown would be only 15 feet. I think everybody in this room would be real happy with a well that performs like this. Okay. So what we did was we ran a 7-day pumping test at an average discharge of 1,230 gallons a minute. You can see here this is the y-axis is our drawdown, the x-axis is time in minutes on a logarithmic scale. So you can see on the drawdown curve here, after about 100 minutes, it started to flatten out. Okay? This is a good thing, okay? Because we think we reached out and hit the river and started actually pump. We're in a fractured limestone aquifer, and we started, our cone of depression reached out and started hitting the river. And so we actually, the drawdown in this well started to stabilize at that point. If we didn't reach out and hit this recharge boundary, you can see the slope of the curve, it's going to start heading down towards the pump, and it might not make a 7-day test. So how are we going to maximize the pump efficiency And I apologize for the way this graph looks. I'm trying to make it very simple for everybody here. Somebody will come in and say, okay, I'm going to need a 450-gallon minute pump, and you're going to need a 20-horsepower pump to do that, is what your driller would tell you. So that's assuming that you've got a well efficiency of 71%. Okay, well, running the step test showed us over here that that our well efficiency is probably only 62% efficient. We can get 550 gallons a minute with a 10-horse pump. So we've cut our pump costs significantly, dropping from a 20-horse pump to a 10-horse pump, and we've got it sized right for the well and the production that we're trying to get out of it. So in this example here, you can see it, if you can read in the back, but this was for a 500 gallon a minute well, specific capacity of 15, 6-inch pipe diameter, and 1,000 foot of pipe, the 9% reduction in pump efficiency in the extra 80 feet ahead that you would have had from the original pump that would have been selected, we ended up saving about $9,200 a year per pivot by doing this step drawdown test up front over a 30-year lifetime of the well. Now we're starting to talk about a savings of $300,000. Okay, that's putting waste into worth in our mind. So, you know, other considerations, you know, do you have good formations? How far is the pipe run from your well to your pivot, and what's your elevation change? And so if you look at, you know, your pipeline length, you know, if you're only 1,000 feet away, it's probably going to cost you about $34,000 a year to run it. But if you're running maybe a kilometer away, 3,000, 3,200 feet away, your pumping costs are going to go up a couple $1,000s a year on that well and on that pivot. The other factor on this is looking at your pipeline diameters from your production well to your pivot. You know, the most expensive cost in installing the pipeline from your well to your pivot is the trenching. It's not the pipeline costs, okay? And some will say, well, we could do it with 4.5-inch casing. Well, based on friction loss associated with a smaller casing or a smaller pipeline, we've got a pumping cost of $37,500. If we go up to a 6-inch casing for the same run, we're dropping our costs by about $2,500 a year. So that becomes significant over the lifetime of this well and pipeline system. So fundamentally, you know, you can save significant operating costs by designing a well properly from the get-go. You select your screen size and slot geometry, your screened intervals, development, testing, sizing your pipelines, and minimizing your pipeline runs. Any questions? Thank you.
Very interesting. Thank you. Thank you.